Thank you very much, Dr. Ammar. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. In the beginning, I would like to thank the SBMT for giving me this great opportunity and for the excellent organization for this conference. We will start now with our first session. We're going to have in this session three talks going to be presented by three distinguished speakers. Each talk is about 30 minutes, divided to 25-minute talks and 5 minutes for the Q&A. We will start now with the first presentation going to be presented by Dr. Mansour Al-Jabri. Dr. Mansour is a well-known consultant and associate professor of hematopathology and transfusion laboratory, and as well as the chairman of pathology and laboratory medicine at the College of Medicine and King Khaled University Hospital. He has been active in a number of research and peer-reviewed journals. Dr. Mansour is going to deliver a talk about diagnostic approach of acute myeloid leukemia. Without further ado, welcome Dr. Mansour. Mic is yours.
Assalamu alaikum. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizing committee for this kind of invitation, and I hope my lecture will meet their expectation. So in the next 30 minutes, inshallah, I will talk about diagnostic approach of acute myeloid leukemia. I try to summarize it as much as I can, because, you know, this is a very long topic. You know, acute myeloid leukemia, as a definition, is an aggressive clonal hematopoietic disorder derived from either hematopoietic stem cells or lineage-specific progenitor cells, which manifest as accumulation of abnormal myeloid blasts in the bone marrow, in peripheral blood, and sometimes in extramedullary hematopoiesis. It manifests as bone marrow failure, anemia, neutropenia, thrombocytopenia, and it might manifest also as organ infiltration, hepatosplenomegaly, and lymphadenopathy in some rare occasions, which will interfere with the normal function of those organs. As you know, acute myeloid leukemia is a hematopoietic stem cell disorder, and hematopoietic stem cell disorder is the mother of the cells that has self-renewal capability and differentiation capability. And if the mutation occurred in the common progenitor, it might give us to mixed lineage or acute leukemia of ambiguous lineage. However, if it is occurred a lymphoid progenitor, it might give rise to acute lymphoblastic leukemia, and sometimes if the mutation leads to accumulation of lymphoid cells, it will give rise to lymphoma, but it is beyond the scope of the lecture. What we are talking about in this square, if the mutation occurred in the myeloid progenitor, which will give rise to different type and different subtypes of acute myeloid leukemia, and myeloproliferative neoplasm, if the mutation leads to accumulation of more mature cells like eosinophils, neutrophils, and so on. So quick insight about the pathogenesis of AML. And you know, leukemia and cancer in general is truly, truly multifactorial disorder in which no factor is sufficient to cause, no single factor is sufficient to cause leukemogenesis. However, it will accumulation of those multiple factors will lead to genetic alteration in the mature precursors, manifested as translocation, sometimes inversion, or sometimes genetic mutations, which will lead to the phenotype that we know, that we see in the peripheral blood and see in the bone marrow, and it will manifest it as the clinical feature of acute myeloid leukemia or cancer in general. So by one of the three mechanisms, sometimes by the three mechanisms together, it will lead to accumulation of the blast in the bone marrow and the peripheral blood. Those mechanisms, it's either block of differentiation through some oncogenes like FLT3, c-KIT mutation, NRAS, KRAS, which will lead to block of differentiation, so accumulation of the blast and prevention of the differentiation process. Again, it might lead to decrease of apoptosis and epigenetic modification through mutation in IDH1, IDH2, which will lead to recruitment of histone D acetylases. Enhanced proliferation, and the best example here is some balanced translocation like BMRRA and A21. So it will lead to the morphology and the clinical feature that we are seeing and dealing with in acute myeloid leukemia. The classification of acute myeloid leukemia in general, according to the WHO, it has been subcategorized to maybe six categories based on several diagnostic tools that has to be applied strictly for consensus between hematopathologists and also consensus between the center. The first category is AML with recurrent genetic abnormality, which include any recurrent genetic abnormality that has a unique clinical pathological signature in prognosis and diagnosis, and also in monitoring of the disease, like translocation 1517 and 821 and so on. And recently, WHO has recognized nucleophosmin, SCABB, and RONOX1 as entity, and some of them are provisional entity. Second is AML with MDS-related changes, which include any case of acute myeloid leukemia when the blast exceeds 20%, and the patient has dysplastic, significant dysplastic changes, or if he's from background of MDS, or if the genetic study shows that he has some MDS-related genetic abnormality. Therapy-related AML, which is a very poor prognostic type of AML, if the patient have history of previous chemotherapy or radiotherapy, myeloid leukemia associated with Down syndrome, which is associated with Down syndrome, and it has two categories, and we will talk in details later about it. AML not otherwise specified, which is the previous fab, as you know, when you cannot fit anyone it does not fit to any one of the recurrent genetic abnormality or the previous category. Myeloid sarcoma, when there is extramedullary blast of myeloid origin. Now, actually, WHO relies on relies on some important diagnostic tool that has to be applied strictly. It include clinical features, morphology, chromosomal karyotype, molecular study, and immunophenotyping by flow cytometry or immunohistochemical stain. The role of clinical features actually is limited to three types three subtypes of acute myeloid leukemia, which is the presence of Down syndrome, which will qualify the disease to be myeloid proliferation of Down syndrome. And if the patient has history of MDS, it will automatically place him in the category of AML with MDS-related changes. Or if he has history of cytotoxic therapy or radiotherapy, he will be classified under category of therapy-related AML after applying the diagnostic algorithm. The morphology is a powerful tool, and it is the primary tool actually for identification and a diagnosis of acute myeloid leukemia. And it has, we have to obtain proper sample, and it has to be fresh sample, and it has to be obtained from the patient without any previous therapy. Whether we obtain the sample from peripheral blood, or we obtain it from bone marrow or adequate biopsy, again, so the morphology is the primary. It is the gate, actually, in the classification and diagnosis of acute myeloid leukemia. It will help us in enumeration and identification of blast count, and it will help us in early recognition of aggressive subtypes like M3, in which we should give the patient ATRA, and we should treat him to prevent the complication like DIC. Identification of myeloid blast feature like our roads, which will help us to guide the immunophenotype and sometimes the molecular panel. Differentiation of blasts and blast equivalent from mature cells. which is clearly aberrant and monocytic lineages, and which we need to differentiate between the monoblast versus promonocyte and abnormal monocytes. And it helped us to properly ordering of ancillary tests like flow cytometry, immunophenotype, which panel we should use, and also genetic study, which panel we should use. And it helped us also in identification of non-blast features like multilineage dysplasia and eosinophilia. Cytochemistry actually has no role in the diagnosis of AMN. However, it is still useful in case of iron study, because when we need to determine if the patient has some dysplastic changes by ring presence of ring sideroblast. Now, in the era of immunophenotyping by flow cytometry and immunohistochemical stain, has no role actually in the diagnosis and classification of acute myeloid leukemia. Flow cytometry is one of the most powerful tool and essential tool in classification and diagnosis and monitoring of disease, and also prediction of prognosis and the target presence of target therapy, such as anti-CD20 or anti-CD38 in multiple myeloma. We can enumerate the blast. We could identify the blast. And when we enumerate off the blast, we have to know that it has some advantage over the manual count. However, it has its own drawback and disadvantage of during if you use, I mean, the count of a blast by flow cytometry. Subclassification of acute myeloid leukemia, specifically the NOS or none otherwise specified, and detection of antigen associated with prognosis like CD56 and some other markers, assessment of minimal residual disease. So now, what are the thing, in which condition you could rely on flow cytometry, and what are the conditions in which we have like false and negative or false positive in calculation and enumeration of the blast using flow cytometry? Because still we know that the manual count is the gold standard for counting of blast. So flow cytometry count might be less than manual count if you have dilution of flow cytometry sample, specifically if you send the second sample for the flow cytometry and the first sample for manual count. Lack of expression of immature markers, if you start calculating the blast using CD34 or TDT or sometimes 99 and T-cell ALL, and some blasts, we know that some blasts are not expressing CD34, like some monoblast, some megakaryoblast, it might lead to reduction of blast by flow cytometry compared with manual count. Some blast equivalent are not included in the blast count, like promonocytes, sometimes promyelocytes. The manual count might include some normal immature precursors, like hematogones or sometimes regenerating myeloblast. And so what are the conditions in which flow cytometry has higher than the manual count and blast enumeration? The last step for RBC might remove some erythroid precursors. Some technicians who have like rigorous lysing for the RBC, he might remove erythroid precursors. So falsely, it will lead to elevate of number of blast. And sometimes by manual count, the blast might be difficult to be recognized, especially in case of dysplasia or post-chemotherapy. And the last state is a condition which apply mainly actually with acute myeloid leukemia with multilineage dysplasia, in which hypogranular mature myeloid cells might fall in the blast region. So if you just use the blast region to calculate the blast by flow cytometry, it might lead to falsely elevation of the number of blasts. Blast identification is the key feature and diagnosis of acute myeloid leukemia. So I will give quick insight about some the most common type of blast, like myeloblast. You can see two hour rods, thin hour rods, which is usually associated with translocation A21. Myeloblast is large nucleus with fine chromatin, prominent nucleoli, and variable number of cytoplasmic granules, plus minus hour rods. And the classical immunophenotype for myeloblast is positivity of CD13, 33, MBO along with CD34. Promyelocyte, which is equivalent to blast only in acute promyelocytic leukemia, as large cells with irregular eccentric nucleus, slightly condensed chromatin, abundant cytoplasm, and it might contain multiple hour rods, which is the phagocyte cells. And the classical immunophenotype for it is bright positive for MBO and negativity of CD34 and HLA-DR. Monoblast is the largest cell maybe in the bone marrow among the blast, excluding the megakaryoblast. It is large cells with round and oval nucleus with prominent nucleoli. And usually the cytoplasm is slightly basophilic and it might contain occasional vacuoles. And the classical immunophenotype for it is positivity of CD13, 33 plus minus CD64 and CD4. Sometimes we have to differentiate between monoblast, promonocyte, and abnormal monocytes. And promonocyte, CD64 is brighter than monoblast, and CD14 again is brighter compared with monoblast, but CD34 is usually negative. This is pro-erythroblast, which is positive for E-cadherin and positive for hemoglobin A, and it is blast equivalent only in case of acute erythroid leukemia. Megakaryoblast with a distinct blebs, and it is positive for CD61 and CD41. So now I will go to the main topic here, which is the diagnostic algorithm, how to assign any case subtype. Now, when we do the morphological assessment plus immunophenotyping using flow cytometry or immunohistochemical stain, we have to evaluate the case. If there is no a myeloid immunophenotype, it is not AML, and we have to behave according to the immunophenotype. And if the immunophenotype is a blast, I mean myeloid immunophenotype, we have to do the proper counting for blast count. If the blast is more than 20%, this is acute myeloid leukemia for sure. And if it is less than 20%, we have to double check the cytogenetic, specifically the recurrent cytogenetic abnormality, in which we could label the patients as acute myeloid leukemia, regardless the number of the blast count, which is A21, emergent 16, or BMR-RARA. And again, we have to double check the history of the patient. If he receive a viral cytotoxic therapy, he will be qualified as therapy-related AML, whatever the conditions that he has. Sometimes if he has translocation A21 and he has history of peripheral cytotoxic therapy, he will be qualified as therapy-related AML with notes that he has translocation A21, because usually the prognosis is very poor, whatever cytogenetic that he has. Now we need to go to the history and we need to double check it. And this is why we are emphasizing that we cannot diagnose any patient without proper history. So we need to double check the cytogenetic. If he has any one of the recurrent cytogenetic abnormality, he will be labeled as AML with recurrent cytogenetic abnormality, whatever morphological features he has. If he has Down syndrome, we need to double check the morphology, and also we need to do the GATA1 mutation just to label him as Down syndrome-related myeloid neoplasm. AML with multilineage dysplasia or MDS-related changes, if he has peripheral MDS or MDS/MBN, or he has MDS-related abnormalities like significant dysplastic changes involving more than 50%, of the lineage, he will be considered as acute myeloid leukemia. Now, the mutational analysis and the genetic analysis, if the patient has like normal karyotype, we have to do the mutational analysis just to double check the CAPPA, RONOX1, and nucleophosmin. And if he has any one of those genetic abnormality, he will be labeled accordingly. And we have, again, to pay attention to MDS-related changes, MDS recurrent genetic abnormality. And if he has any one of MDS recurrent genetic abnormality, you need to go back and to diagnose him as AML with multilineage dysplasia. And mutation analysis for prognosis will be done for him. Now, quick slides about the therapy-related AML. Therapy-related AML is any AML that occur after cytotoxic or radiation therapy for malignant or non-neoblastic conditions. It has been divided according to the latency period of AML post-chemotherapy to short latency therapy-related AML. And usually it is associated with topoisomerase to inhibitor like etoposide, in which the disease occur usually after 2 to 3 years. And it's often associated with monoblast or myelomonocytic leukemia with MLL mutation. Long latency therapy-related AML usually occur after alkylating agent, and it is usually associated with multilineage dysplasia and complex karyotype. Prognosis is very poor as a result of drug resistant and limited tolerance to chemotherapy. And if you see this case, this is one of our cases. He's 4 weeks old infant presented with fever and jaundice, and he has mild hepatosplenomegaly and no lymphadenopathy. And he has mild leukocytosis and mild anemia and thrombocytopenia. And if you see his peripheral smear, he has around 33% immature looking blast, and if you see the morphology, if you see cytoplasmic clipping on the cytoplasm, so we have to think that we are dealing with megakaryoblast. We did the bone marrow and we discovered that he has multiple large blasts with distinct blib, as you can see here by arrow, along with significant dysplastic changes in the megakaryocyte. If you see the white arrow, it is pointing toward dysplastic megakaryoblast. So he has 60% blast with significant dysplasia involving only the megakaryoblast, while erythropoiesis and granulobiesis is normal. By flow cytometry, he has 53% blast, which are positive for CD45, CD7, CD33, 41, and 61. So when we do the karyotype, we discover that he has trisomy 21, and he has also GATA1 mutation, so he has been labeled as transient abnormal myelopoiesis. So what is the So my voice is clear now.
Yeah, it's clear. Go ahead.
Yeah. So are there any way to differentiate between transient abnormal myelopoiesis and myeloid leukemia associated Down syndrome? Usually, blast by immunomorphologies are indistinguishable. In fact, but in transient abnormal myeloblasts, it is usually associated with isolated GATA1 mutation, and you should not see any complex karyotype or any translocation, recurrent translocation associated with AML, like translocation 122. If you see any complex karyotype, this is myeloid leukemia associated with Down syndrome, and it is not transient abnormal myeloblasts. By morphology, usually transient abnormal myeloblasts associated with dysplasia in megakaryocytes only. It is not associated with multilineage dysplasia. AML with recurrent genetic abnormality, and it is well known, so I don't think that I will add too much to to you by talking about those very famous recurrent cytogenic abnormality. However, if you see AML with translocation A21, and if you see it resulted RONUX and RONUX1 mutation and presence of A21.
Dr. Mansour, three minutes.
So, okay, I will go to the inversion 16. I mean, you can see inversion 16 is associated with myelomonocytic blast, and usually it leads to high DAC and recruitment of histone deacetylation and the block of differentiation. I will not talk about this one. I will show you just a very interesting case here. If you can see here flow cytometry histogram, you can see here by side scatter CD45, you can see two population of blast, the red blast and also the green one. And if you when we actually test them with flow cytometry immunophenotype, we discovered that we are dealing with myeloblasts, which are positive for CD34 and positive for 117 and positive for CD33. And we are dealing with basophils, in fact. If you see, it is positive for 123 and negative for CD34. And we discovered that we are dealing with AML with translocation 6-9, which is commonly associated with basophilia, and it is usually associated with poor prognosis. You can see this is the morphology of this immunophenotype. AML with genetic abnormality like mutated nucleophosmin, you can see the cup-like nuclear inclusions. AML with biallelic mutation CABPA, it is usually associated with myelomonocytic leukemias, and it is of good prognosis. So I don't have time to talk about it. And I will go to the pure erythroid leukemia because they keep changing the definition of pure erythroid leukemia. And if you can see those blasts, those deeply basophilic blasts, and the bone marrow biopsy is totally infiltrated by those purely poorly undifferentiated pro-erythroblasts. CD34 is commonly negative. Ecadrine is the strong positive in early precursors. And if you see glycophorin and CD71 are both positive. So this algorithm, it will help you to identify any erythroid leukemia or sometimes whether you are dealing with MDS or therapy-related AML, or you are dealing with pure erythroid leukemia. If you have erythroid hyperplasia and more than 50% and dysplasia, you have to exclude the non-neoplastic conditions, especially erythropoietin therapy, sometimes folate and B12. If you have exclude the reactive causes, you have to do the recurrent cytogenic abnormality. If any one of the recurrent cytogenic abnormality, the diagnosis should be changed accordingly. History is very important. MDS-related changes has to be excluded also. We do not need now to calculate the blast out of non-erythroid cells, because if the blast is less than 20%, this is MDS with excess blast. Pure erythroid leukemia will be labeled only if you have more than 80% erythroid precursors and with more than 30% pro-erythroblast. Okay, acute megakaryoblastic leukemia is commonly presenting with large megakaryoblast and severe thrombocytopenia and CD41 and CD61. This is one of my cases, actually. If you see the morphology here, as poorly differentiated blast with microvacuoles in the cytoplasm, and the flow cytometry was positive for CD4 and 56, and CD4 is bright positive with HLA-DR, so it was blastic plasmacytoid dendritic cells, which is the last one. So just to sum up and to summarize, the application of diagnostic tools for acute myeloid leukemia. For morphology, the material used here is bone marrow aspirate biopsy, peripheral smear, or bone marrow aspirate sometimes. So morphological assessment is quite useful in AML diagnosis and AML subtyping, but it is not of benefit in predicting the prognosis or identifying the treatment therapy. Cytochemistry can help in AML diagnosis, especially if you are in an under-resourced lab. Immunophenotyping for flow cytometry or immunohistochemical stain is quite useful in AML diagnosis and AML subtyping also, and it is quite helpful in identification of target therapy. Chromosomal analysis is quite useful almost in all stages of the diseases, starting from diagnosis until identifying the treatment target and also in MRD assessment. A mutation analysis using next generation sequencing, it is not useful usually in diagnosis, but it's quite useful in subtyping and predicting of prognosis and target therapy. Laboratory tests, they are quite helpful in predicting of prognosis. So just to conclude, the diagnosis of AML, it involves multimodality approach involving integration of history, clinical presentation, and new lab results for better characterization and classification. And the classification in turn provides valuable information regarding the prognosis and identification of treatment target. So sometimes it's quite difficult to summarize everything and to summarize almost half of your work, daily work on 30 minutes. So I hope that I do my best to summarize all the aspects of acute myeloid leukemia, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mansour, for this excellent presentation. I cannot see any question in the Q&A, so we may proceed for the second talk. Thank you again, Dr. Mansour.
Thank you.